Hello and welcome. I'm Chaiti Narula, and this is a special broadcast that discusses the impact of the pandemic in the sporting world in Mumbai. While on one hand, the sporting associations in Mumbai have lauded the government's efforts in trying to contain the pandemic, the losses that they suffer monetarily are huge. The athletes have lost an entire year in 2020, and with the restrictions in Mumbai in 2021, the light at the end of the tunnel has faded away yet again. Mumbai's coronavirus crisis is a matter of huge concern. The financial capital is witnessing a sharp surge, and viewers, that is a reality. This now begs the question, how will certain sport promoters survive this? What happens to the fate of the athletes in the long haul in their careers? The government, of course, finds itself in a rather precarious situation and has to contain the virus. They don't have a choice. While the IPL will now go on as usual in Mumbai, minus the spectators and all the fanfare that we are used to, but can the other sports survive? What does the lay of the land look like? And if IPL can be conducted without any spectators, why not the other sports? For instance, the sport of horse racing is already hit by the high GST, and 2020 was a huge dampener. The Mumbai Marathon has been postponed. The IPL organizers have a huge task ahead of them to enforce biosafety protocols rigorously. Even the equestrian league stands to be cancelled. I'm going to straight go across to all my guests here. I'm going to introduce them first. Borya Majumdar, our consulting editor. Anil Singh, the managing director of ProCam International. Sunil Jhangiani, he's a horse owner and he's a former committee member of the Royal Western India Turf Club in Mumbai. Let's begin the show with Anil Singh, the managing director of ProCam. Anil, what does the lay of the land look like for sport in Mumbai? Your marathon was postponed. How do you feel the government has responded to it? And what is the fate of athletes and sport promoters like you?
Well, Chaiti, thank you for having me. And, you know, good afternoon to everybody, to all your viewers. Now, that's a huge question you put forward, which has got a multiple array of answers.
Yeah.
So I will try and make it as succinct as possible. You know, I think, yes, there was light that was shining around January. Things were getting better. Things could be a little bit planned. And we could kind of see as to when our world of sport in its original avatar could possibly unfold in smaller ways and then possibly lead to a full resurgence of the way things seems to be. However, you know, when you say sport, we must be clear that, you know, you can't brush sport from a canvas of sport into the same lens, i.e., you have spectatorial sport, which is cricket, hockey, kabaddi, football, IPL, etc., whatever it is. Where people, when it's more television-oriented for the world to see. And you don't really, you can still survive without having spectators, although you lose that luster and sheen, for sure. But when it comes to participative sport, i.e. distance running, marathons, cycling, triathlon, swimming, et cetera, you know, that obviously is going to hurt because that means a congregation of a large number of people. So the lens is slightly different. I understand the government's concerns and I understand the government's thinking in terms of what can go ahead and what should not be allowed to go ahead. And that's fair. To be honest, that's fair. But, you know, when you say...
But, you know, you mentioned the government right now, Anil. I just want to quickly check, has the government provided all the assistance that is required to the sporting world as well in Mumbai?
Now, you know, I don't know what you mean by that in terms of its exactitude. They are a very supportive government. There's no argument about that. And whether it's the center or whether it's the state, both are very keen to get life and sport. You know, sport plays a dual and a triple role. One is about immunity, health, and your participation and your involvement and your kind of what it does for you. The second, of course, is the kind of revenues it brings to a state. That's a very important part. And also it shows the sign that shows all is well or getting better. So it's a little bit of a tricky situation to give it exactitudes and answers, but In terms of support, I mean, the center has issued some financial SOPs to be able to help, as a small case, scale industries to sort of SMEs, what they call medium-sized enterprises, to be able to sort of be supported. But given what a slightly bigger company would have to think, it's not adequate. That's for sure.
Sure.
And but there are many other ways the government can help. The double taxation GST that is hitting us, in any case for the last 2 years, can be reviewed. Because that's a double taxation issue that we are facing.
Yeah.
So given all these things, it's a little bit of a, there is no clear answer, to put it simply.
All right. Anil, hold on your thoughts right there. Let me also show what is happening as far as the Indian Premier League is concerned. And of course, the Indian Pandemic League will be a more apt usage of the term at this point of time with all that's going on after 2020. The season in UAE, the IPL, of course, is back in India. There will be no spectators allowed at the stadiums. Only 6 venues, 60 matches played over 51 days. There are going to be bio bubbles, constant testing of players, constant testing of staff. At least 4 IPL players, if you remember, tested positive. Some also have recovered. Now that begs the big question, if the IPL can happen, why not the other sport? But I'm going to come back to that in just about a bit. Boria, this morning you've written a very interesting article on the biosafety protocol that is going to be implemented rigorously. If you could explain how Wankhede in Mumbai plans to do that in the light of the rising number of COVID cases and show the world that the show still can go on, unlike the other sports that have cancelled, maybe due to government restrictions or their own calls that they've taken.
First things first, there are 3 points here, and very briefly, because you've got to get your other speakers in. One, should sport continue? Has to continue, because this is a part of life now. It is not going to go away tomorrow or April 30th or May 30th. It will be there for a while. Yes, in the UK, there is light. You are seeing 10,000 people. Wembley, they are trying that out. And with vaccination in multiple countries, Israel, even the US, UK, we have evidence that it will get better. Science will win. That's a given, but it's long term. So in short term, what do you have to do? In the Wankhede, for example, you asked me that, multiple bubbles have to be implemented. One, the player bubbles. So the players will only be occupying particular hotels, particular floors, get access to no one. Number two, officials, which includes Saurav, Jay, the BCCI top brass. Number three, broadcaster, which will include the host broadcaster, who will have all the rights to get inside the venue. But even the host broadcaster should not have access to the players. Number four, and very important, groundsmen, technical people. The Wankhede groundsman got infected because, that is where we tend to become lax, because you don't put them in bubbles. Now they have been put in bubbles. And here, somebody like an Anil Singh, and I'm giving Anil Singh's example as a figurative one. I'm smiling because you know why. Suppose an Anil Singh enters a CCI, will anyone stop him? No,
not
he will
all.
Not be stopped. Why? Because he's Anil Singh. Now, and in Anil's case, he will not go because he's responsible enough. But will others be responsible enough? Or will they say, I am an official, I will go, and the groundsman will have no authority, the security personnel, no authority to stop that official. That is the Jugaad culture. That is the culture of entitlement that we have in this country in sports administration for ages. Can the BCCI go against the grain of this? They have to. I've had multiple conversations with the BCCI top brass. Saurav's going to Chennai today, and he knows what he has on hand. This tournament is on an eggshell. The moment you make or allow for breaches, even one, you can have egg on your face, and the whole world will say, India couldn't do it. So this is an opportunity. Even with the 100,000 cases, you've been able to pull off the IPL, revenue happens. You asked about revenue. And IPL is not about 200 elite players.
Yeah.
That money will go down to the under 13, under 16, women, groundsmen, state association, broadcaster, television, journalists. So it is a whole ecosystem we are talking about, Chaiti. That is why I feel the tournament has to go on. But your question about double standards, the biggest double standard in the country, political rallies. 10 lakh people in Bengal every single day. If that can go on, the jury is out.
And Boria, you're right. We are discussing politics throughout the day. I'm just taking a break and discussing sport right now. So I'm coming back to that point as well. But I want to bring our viewers up to speed with a horse racing dilemma as well. Now, horse racing, just a little while back, there was a notification that said, in the view of the latest restrictions, horse racing season, that is the rest of the pending season, stands to be cancelled. Now, understand one thing. Horse racing can also happen behind closed doors, like the way IPL is taking place, minus the spectators. Maintaining a horse is extremely expensive. The high GST has already slowly killing the sport in this country. The owners are suffering from huge losses. There is no scope for new owners with all that is transpiring at the moment. I want to bring in Sunil Jangiani, who's a horse owner. He's a former committee member of the Royal Western India Turf Club as well. Sunil, good afternoon. Thanks for taking time out. What happened there? Why was the horse racing season cancelled, put on hold? Was that the government notification? Was it the club's decision? My question is simple. If the IPL can take place without spectators, couldn't horse racing rest of the season also take place? Because you have GST that has already killed the sport, and the sport cannot afford to have this anymore.
Hi, Chetty. So before I answer your question specifically, I just want to inform you and the viewers as to what GST has done to the sport.
Yeah.
In 2000, I think 3 years ago, the turnover of the horse racing industry, it's not a big turnover in terms of sport, was about 4,000 crores. And the government was making about 400 crores in GST revenue. Post the increase to 28% GST, the turnover has dropped to 1,200 crores. This is pre-pandemic. So post-pandemic is probably even worse, much lower than that. And it's not even a smart tax because the government's actually made less revenue from the GST. So it's not benefiting the industry. It's not benefiting the government. It seems to be more image-building tax or a sin tax to, you know, so that the government looks good in not promoting something that's associated with gambling. Whereas it's not just gambling. There are a lot of owners, many owners, most owners, who don't really are interested in the sport and not in the gambling part of it. Now, to answer your question, as far as the lockdown and this, the management of the RWITC, I think the current management has followed the letter of the law. However, I don't see any reason. We have big grounds. If this is all about containment and congregation.
And Sunil, since you mentioned least... big grounds, let me mention 250 or 225 thereabout acres of land at the Royal Western India Turf Club at the Mahalakshmi Racecourse, with 50 thereabout square area. I don't know exactly what the terminology is. Please explain to me.
But it could have
still been conducted.
Of course it could have been, because you're talking about 50 acres.
Acres, correct.
Land.
That's what the word I was
you're
looking
for. About 50 acres. The rest is, of course, track and stables and everything. But 50 acres of land, and if you have a card of 10 races with 9 horses running in each race, that's totally 90 race horses on a day. And there are 3 stakeholders, main stakeholders, which is the jockey, the owner, and the trainer, and the officials. You're talking about 300 or 400 people. 300 or 400 people in 50 acres. I mean, there was no reason. And here the problem is the sport, the backbone of the sport is the owners and the fans. And both are getting deprived now. The owners are deprived.
No, and you know, Sunil, why I understand it's a, you know, it's a sport where there are those purists and they will always be able to maintain their horses, pay their BTF, etc., etc. But then how do you bring in new owners in if, you know, racing does not even continue like that without spectators?
Well, that's why the number of owners is dwindling. The race, the number of people attending racing is going down. So there are many problems. And I think this is just, you know, another situation which is making things worse. I feel that just to restore confidence in the owners and in the fans and in the people who attend racing and who basically are interested in racing, the show should have gone on.
Yeah, that's the point I was trying to drive home, and I'm going to bring in Anil on this one as well.
If I just want to interrupt for a second,
go on.
To add to what Sunil is saying, or just to create a small difference. You know, in a way, I can truly understand why the racing is not going on. And it's not rocket science. You see, at the end of the day, if spectators are not allowed to be there and experience the sport, brands cannot do any kind of customization, touch or feel, etc. The biggest problem that racing has, there is no broadcast deal. There is no broadcast deal, so there is no amplification in terms of reaching out to people or homes. Now, if you're not going to have a broadcast deal, if you can't have spectators coming, If you don't have any of these, or you don't have a big digital online telecast, you know, whether it's on Facebook or Google, if you don't have any of these structures in place, does racing really make sense? Because what happens with that, there's a cost. Yes. There is all that comes into it. And we are doing it for what? For the 200 owners to watch it? So the issue is
very, very good point.
That,
you know? And you know, Anil has hit the nail on his head when he says that, you know, perhaps there is also the internal structuring and the construct that needs to be revisited as far as this sport is concerned, which is the sport of horse racing. But now, like the overall big questions here are, how much are athletes across the board suffering? How can you protect the athlete or carry on with any sport for that matter? How bad is the toll on the sporting calendars? What kind of losses does the sporting industry really incur? And how will owners and businesses really survive? Can sports other than cricket even pull through? How long can the ecosystem even stay on like this? And because Anil is a sport promoter, I want to bring him in on this one. Anil, keeping racing aside, can sports other than cricket pull through? What is going on with overall the sports industry, whether when it comes to participative sports like your marathon, which can't go on because you can't have people in?
So when it comes to participative sport, the global athletes are suffering tremendously. And you know, there's no better case in point than when we did the Airtel Delhi half marathon in Delhi in the month of December last year, which was only the elite field. You know, we had the world's best participating because they wanted an opportunity. And the Delhi government was very generous enough to support it, obviously without the participants, except for the world elite athlete field running on the streets like a normal day. So if you're talking about athletes involved in participative sport, they are hurting beyond. And the other problem that comes with that, Boria will be able to explain this even better, that if you look at it, the Olympics, so it's all about running and, you know, that kind of a thing. So the Olympics, which is right around the corner, you know, all these events that you would have normally participated to hone, to know, to test on all different levels that an athlete has to map in order to be successful and to know what, how, which, and tactically, and many other sides of it, that is hurting too. So there are many lenses. But if you talk about professional soccer, professional baseball, professional cricketers, whatever the professional of those sport, basketball, they are not hurting at all. Outside the fact that they are not being able to maximize, I guess, their own personal endorsement deals, etc., because of so many touch points there. But even then, there are companies that handle that for them. So there are two lenses. The participative sport world is hurting. The others, not really a difference. It's not creating.
That's a very interesting viewpoint, because that clarifies quite a bit as well, because most people think that all of sport is hurting, and that's not true. And that's a clarification coming in from Anil. We also have a focus on Mumbai now because it's the worsted city in terms of COVID. And despite many curbs and restrictions in place, the iconic Wankhede is going to be playing to host 10 IPL games. And four teams are going to be seen playing in their home games in the city. And these are Chennai Super Kings, Delhi Capitals, Rajasthan Royals, and Punjab Kings. Borya, how excited is the sporting world? Finally, there is something that is happening in Mumbai. They can't even go for it, but at least they can watch it. And that is the power of the broadcast deals that you have in place. It has to be televised. And this is a lesson that, like Anil said, every other sport under the sun can take in having the right kind of broadcast deal so that the sport at least can go on. Borya?
You know, whether it is Mumbai or Antarctica, how does it matter? The fact is, I'm going to watch it on TV. The fact is that night curfew that has kicked in actually gives you something to look forward to. So my day, for example, I'll do India Today. I'll do our digital platform, Sports Today. I will write, I'll watch the game, I'll analyze it. The next morning I get up, there's another game. Weekends, there are double headers. So all of a sudden, you will see people sitting at home with a preoccupation. That's what sport does. So the moment the IPL gets over, you'll have the World Test Championship in England. Moment that gets over, you have the Olympics in Tokyo. And you will have sport. What is good about sport? Unlike politics, which is all toxic, sport will be positive. Sport will give you something to look forward to. It is aspirational. There are no retakes, and you know this is flesh and blood. That is why I welcome the IPL. To stop the IPL is not the solution. to stop sporting events like Tokyo is not the solution. Where do you go with it? You will further economically damage yourself, further add negativity. Rather, figure out ways to do it, because this is your world and you've got to grapple with it and live with it. And to just add to the point that Anil was making, make a distinction between elite sport, high-performance sport and participatory sport. The moment you do that, you will understand it. Every Olympic athlete you asked whether they will survive or not, everyone will survive.
And you know, nobody could have put it better than Borya and Anil Singh, who I have on this broadcast, because they breathe sport. So I just want to I have a minute left on the show. I just want to bring Sunil Jangiani also in. Sunil, what are the lessons that the pandemic has taught your sport, and what next for your sport in this country?
Look, I think that all sports that have made a digital transformation are going to survive. Unfortunately, we have no reach right now. The reach is very limited, and we need to expand that reach. And that once that reach, if we can expand that reach, like Anil said, do broadcast deals, go digital, make the sport popular, try and reach out to more people. However, we are limited. We have problems with the GST. There's not enough people coming. The revenue is hurting. So all of the challenges are there. I think the way forward is very clear, but without us getting something on the GST, it's going to be very difficult.
So you're dealing with a fundamental problem of GST having hit the sport already. So the pandemic is just coming in as a double whammy for a sport which is already hit. And I saw Borya's hand up. I think he wants to make a winding comment. So Borya and Anil, go first, Borya.
It's a one-year issue, Chaiti. 1 year. You've passed 1 year. Take a look at the Spanish flu, look at vaccination, look at the country, look at Europe, look at the US, look at the UK, look at the number of vaccinations in India. It's a 1 year deal. And it's also about us. Let us follow protocol. We will survive. Everyone will survive. There is light at the end of the tunnel, always was. Civilization wins, science wins, sport will win. So it's a 1 year deal. Each of us will have to go through hardship. Because ultimately, if we love our sport, we'll make it work. I keep saying this. This will pass.
Very well said. I want to bring in Anil. Anil, will this pass? How hopeful are you of the light at the end of the tunnel now? All right. We've lost the audio to Anil Singh right there. We've lost that particular audio. If we can fix that. All right. With that, that's all the time that I have. Unfortunately, we've lost his audio right there. I thank you very, very much, Borya, Anil Singh, Sunil Jangiani, for joining us. Such is life at the moment. The COVID pandemic has hit the world of sport very hard, but there are ways and means to conduct sport, as well as Borya, Anil and Sunil explain. With that, it's a wrap from me, Chaiti, on this special broadcast. Coming up next is my colleague, Balami Saha from West Bengal.
Hi everyone, Preeti Chaudhary here. Hope you like this video. For latest news and analysis, like and subscribe to the India Today YouTube channel. And don't forget to press the bell icon to stay updated. Thank you for watching.